Simon & Schuster Audio presents Wiseguy by Nicholas Pileggi. Read by Ari Fliakos with Corey Brill and Hilary Huber. And introduced by Martin Scorsese.
The first time I read Wiseguy, I was astonished. It was everything I'd hoped for, and then some. Some of the greatest actors I ever knew were people from my old neighborhood. The guys who could keep you absolutely riveted when they told you a story. Their story. Nick Pileggi knew the world of Italian-American culture inside out, and he understood that storytelling was fundamental, from the people who succeeded and assimilated to the ones who were stuck in the middle, the ones who tried to be decent but somehow couldn't. Nick knew every side of this bygone world, and he never judged anyone for what they said or did. And he knew that if the story was really going to be told, he had to find exactly the right person to tell it. In Henry Hill, Nick found someone with access to every level of the life, who knew it on a daily, minute-by-minute basis, who was ready and willing to tell his story as an act of survival. Nick had grown bored with, as he puts it, the egomaniacal ravings of illiterate hoods masquerading as benevolent godfathers. Henry was an insider and something of an outsider at the same time, and he wanted, even needed, to remember everything down to the smallest detail. Of course, when I read the book that first time, I found it hard to put down. I found myself making notes, visualizing movements, cuts, passages of music. I realized I had to make this movie. For me, it was an evolution in a direct line with what I try to do in Mean Streets. Only here, there was no central character per se, no equivalent to Charlie. The lifestyle was so big and so compelling that there was no need for a main character, just someone to guide us along. I saw the possibility of making the lifestyle itself the main character. When I called Nick, I asked him to write the script with me for what would eventually become Goodfellas. I think he was a little surprised, but excited. I wanted to stay as close to the facts as we could. There was a natural rise and fall narrative there, but that wasn't what made it special. It was the places, the restaurants and bars, the food they ate, the clothes, sense of style, the gestures, the body language, the way of being with one another, the ease with which they committed murder. On the one hand, an immersion in detail that was sensual and documentary at the same time. On the other hand, a forward propulsion that moved with their energy and exhilaration and then with their paranoia and stone-cold fear. We had a great time putting it together. Nick is one of the greatest collaborators anyone could ever hope for. Patient, hard-working, detail-oriented, and absolutely concentrated on the work. I often think back to that first reading of Wiseguy and the sense of excitement I felt. Nick and I have been good friends for years now. We've made a second movie together, and fingers crossed we'll get to make a few more. But I need him to know just how special our collaboration has been to me. It all started with this book, which you're about to hear. If it's your first time, set aside a few hours, because you won't be able to stop listening.
Introduction. On Tuesday, May 22nd, 1980, a man named Henry Hill did what seemed to him the only sensible thing to do. He decided to cease to exist. He was in the Nassau County Jail facing a life sentence in a massive narcotics conspiracy. The federal prosecutors were asking him about his role in the $6 million Lufthansa German Airlines robbery, the largest successful cash robbery in American history. The New York City police were in line behind the feds to ask him about the 10 murders that followed the Lufthansa heist. The Justice Department wanted to talk to him about his connection with the murder that also involved Michela Sindona, the convicted Italian financier. The Organized Crime Strike Force wanted to know about the Boston College basketball players he had bribed in a point-shaving scheme. Treasury agents were looking for the crates of automatic weapons and Claymore mines he had stolen from a Connecticut armory. The Brooklyn District Attorney's Office wanted information about a body they had found in a refrigeration truck, which was frozen so stiff it needed 2 days to thaw before the medical examiner could perform an autopsy. When Henry Hill had been arrested only 3 weeks earlier, it hadn't been big news. There were no front-page stories in the newspapers and no segments on the evening news. His arrest was just another of dozens of the slightly exaggerated multi-million-dollar drug busts that police make annually in their search for paragraphs of praise. But the arrest of Henry Hill was a prize beyond measure. Hill had grown up in the mob. He was only a mechanic, but he knew everything. He knew how it worked. He knew who oiled the machinery. He knew literally where the bodies were buried. If he talked, the police knew that Henry Hill could give them the key to dozens of indictments and convictions. And even if he didn't talk, Henry Hill knew that his own friends would kill him, just as they had killed nearly everyone who had been involved in the Lufthansa robbery. In jail, Henry heard the news. His own protector, Paul Vario, the 70-year-old mob chief in whose house Henry had been raised from childhood, was through with him. And James Jimmy the Gent Burke, Henry's closest friend, his confidant and partner, the man he had been scheming and hustling with since he was 13 years old, was planning to murder him. Under the circumstances, Henry made his decision. He became part of the Justice Department's Federal Witness Protection Program. His wife, Karen, and their children, Judy, 15, and Ruth, 12, ceased to exist along with him. They were given new identities. It should be said that it was slightly easier for Henry Hill to cease to exist than it might have been for an average citizen, since the actual evidence of Hill's existence was extraordinarily slim. His home was apparently owned by his mother-in-law. His car was registered in his wife's name. His social security cards and driver's licenses, he had several of each, were forged and made out to fictitious names. He had never voted, and he had never paid taxes. He had never even flown on an airplane using a ticket made out in his own name. In fact, one of the only pieces of documentary evidence that proved without doubt that Henry Hill had lived, besides his birth certificate, was his yellow sheet, the police record of arrests he had begun as a teenage apprentice to the mob. A year after Henry Hill's arrest, I was approached by his attorney, who said that Hill was looking for someone to write his story. At that point, I had been writing about organized crime figures for most of my career as a journalist and had gotten bored with the egomaniacal ravings of illiterate hoods masquerading as benevolent godfathers. In addition, I had never heard of Henry Hill. In my office are four boxes of index cards upon which I compulsively jot the names and various details of every major and minor organized crime figure I run across in the press or court dockets. When I looked in it, I discovered I had a card on Hill, dated from 1970, and misidentifying him as a member of the Joseph Bonanno crime family. And yet, from the mountain of data the feds had begun to compile about him since his arrest a year earlier, and the importance they attached to him as a witness, it was clear that Henry Hill was at least worth meeting. Since he was in the federal witness program, the meeting had to take place at a location where his safety was guaranteed. I was instructed to meet two federal marshals at the Braniff counter at LaGuardia Airport. When I got there, the two men had my ticket in their hands. They asked if I had to go to the bathroom. It struck me as a bizarre question, coming from federal agents, but they explained that once they gave me the ticket, I could not leave their sight until we boarded the plane. They couldn't take the chance that I might see the destination and tip someone off as to where I was going. As it turned out, the plane we took was not a Braniff plane, and the first place we landed was not the place where Henry Hill was waiting. It took more than one flight that day to finally get to a town where, I learned later, Hill and his federal agent bodyguards had arrived just a couple of hours earlier. Hill was a surprising man. He didn't look or act like most of the street hoods I had come across. He spoke coherently and fairly grammatically. He smiled occasionally. He knew a great deal about the world in which he had been raised, but he spoke about it with an odd detachment, and he had an outsider's eye for detail. Most of the mobsters who have been interviewed for books and articles over the years have been unable to detach themselves from their experiences long enough to put their lives in some perspective. They so blindly followed the mobster's path that they rarely saw any of the scenery along the way. Henry Hill was all eyes. He was fascinated by the world in which he had grown up, and there was very little about it that he did not remember. Henry Hill was a hood. He was a hustler. He had schemed and plotted and broken heads. He knew how to bribe and he knew how to con. He was a full-time working racketeer, an articulate hoodlum from organized crime, the kind of rara avis that should please social anthropologists as much as cops. On the street, He and his friends referred to each other as wise guys. It seemed to me that a book about his life might provide an insider's look at a world usually heard about either from the outside or from the capo di tutti capi, top.
1. Henry Hill was introduced to life in the mob almost by accident. In 1955.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.